Okay, very well. So, good afternoon, everyone, wherever you are, as usual. I don't know if anyone of you is watching me in his bath, for example. That could be quite funny. So, this lecture follows last week's lecture on Green's function. So, and today is devoted to the GW formalism. So, the G is a Green's function, the time ordered Green's function we have been seeing last week, and W is a screen Coulomb potential that I would be telling you about in the slides to come. So bibliography is big. I started by one of the most recent book devoted to many body Green's function perturbation theory, but to interacting electrons in general with Richard Martin, Lucia Reining, and David Sepperle. And you have also, of course, articles, starting with the seminal article by Lars Edin. And I put in red the date, 65. So it is the same year as the Cohn-Sham article. So as you can see, the GW formalism and the DFT formalism, actually they came on Earth roughly at the same time. Even though ab initio implementation of the GW formalism came a bit later in the 80s. So if you want to read about the GW formalism, I advise you to go to these references. If you are a PhD student, PhD manuscripts are very good, because usually when you are a PhD student, you bother about all the details. When you are a researcher, you believe you know enough to not to talk about the details, but most of the time it's just that you forgot. And I also flash out a paper by Cederbaum and co-worker, which points to a technique which is called the algebraic diagrammatic construction, which is also a Green's function perturbation theory, but with a different expansion. So, to some extent, the GW formalism and the concept of self-energy has an equivalent in the field of quantum chemistry. So my first slide will be, I just want to make sure you are at the right place and you came for the right lecture. So what is the GW formalism about? So the GW formalism in brief, in a nutshell, it's aiming at calculating electronic energy levels, namely band structure or HOMO, LUMO, if you are a quantum chemist, ionization potential and electronic affinity. So namely it's trying to get these energy levels with which we are familiar as soon as we have a lecture of quantum mechanics, quantum chemistry or solid state physics. So it's a perturbative technique. It's not exact. In principle, we could converge to an exact technique, but the cost would be prohibitive. And it's based on the one-body Green's function as a working variable in contrast with DFT and TD-DFT, which is working with a charge density. So an important aspect is that it's a cheap technique. What I mean is that you have a lot of very nice techniques in quantum chemistry or to deal with electronic energy levels, but this approach is rather low level. Mainly, it's scaling as the power four of the size of the system, which means that today you can do hundreds of atoms. And as you will see, the ratio between accuracy and CPU time is quite impressive to my taste. And all the more as nowadays there is a blooming of papers related to a cubic scaling formalism. And I mean an exact cubic scaling formalism, not something which is relying on approximations. Another aspect which may be of interest for quantum chemists is that it's a technique which originated from solid state physics, which means that it was developed first for extended solids. And it's now used for finite size cluster organic molecules. And what is quite nice as well is that it can be used for metallic systems. There is no divergency if you use a GW formalism with a zero gap system as you may face with some quantum chemistry type of calculation. So it's very versatile. You can go to finite size or extended system, semiconducting or metallic systems with an accuracy which is quite good in general, but this we will be talking about it at the end of this presentation. So reminder of last week we talked about the time order, the Green's function, and this is what we wrote concerning the spectral representation of the Green's function, where at the numerator, the spectral weight, you have what are called the Lehmann weights. And what is quite nice is that the poles of the Green's function are very much related to what we call energy addition or electron addition or electron removal energies, which are really what a photoemission experiment is doing, direct or inverse, when it's giving you the energy of an electron or the energy of a hole into an electron system. And as we have seen, the time order Green's function has poles corresponding to occupied states in the upper half plane, complex plane, and has poles associated with the unoccupied or virtual levels in the lower half plane, with the ionization potential, which is the smallest ionization potential, and the electronic affinity at the bottom, or minus the LUMO energy at the bottom of the unoccupied states. And so I flash again this transparency to tell you that the poles of the Green's function are the proper definition of electronic energy levels, which contrast with, for example, Kohn-Cham, ansatz, or Hartree-Fock ansatz for electronic energy level, which we will see are most of the time extremely inaccurate when attempting to reproduce a band structure. The last reminder of last week is the little exercise we did as an introduction to GW. We looked at the operator, which is a product of the Green's function with the bare Coulomb potential under the form of this little integral with eta, a small positive infinitesimal, allowing to close your integral in the upper half plane. And we demonstrated that the JV operator is exactly the exact exchange operator, provided that you can identify the Lehmann weights to one-body molecular orbitals, which we could do if you have independent electron systems. So I've been discussing the Green's function G, so now the other actor in the GW formalism is the screen Coulomb potential. So I will discuss with the ends what is the screen Coulomb potential. So let's assume, doing a photoemission experiment, that you add a charge, could be an electron or a hole, on top of your n electron system. So that would be this charge Q, could be positive and negative. And due to Coulomb and exchange repulsion, due to electron-electron interaction, we know that this added electron is going to induce a rearrangement of charge around itself. As a matter of fact, if it's a negative charge, if it's an electron, it's going to repel the electrons, namely it's going to create what is called an exchange correlation hole around itself. So this rearrangement of charge, which I call delta N induced, is related or is introducing the electronic susceptibility key, which is the linear response coefficient between the applied potential, here the Coulomb potential generated by the added charge, and the induced rearrangement of charge. And so in the language of the GW formalism, the object, the composite object, which is composed from the added charge plus its depletion hole, is called the Dressed particle, a Dressed electron or a Dressed hole, or a quasi-particle in the language of the GW of many body perturbation theory. So a quasi-particle is the electron plus the rearrangement of charge is creating once it introduced in your an electron system. So, what is the potential generated by this quasi-particle? So it's quite simple. You have the Coulomb potential generated by the bare charge located in R0, and you have also the potential, the R3 potential, generated by the rearrangement of the charge. So since this rearrangement of charge is equal to Q times the Coulomb potential, you can see that the potential generated by the quasi-particle or the Dressed electron or the Dressed hole is equal to W, the screen Coulomb potential, which is equal to the bare Coulomb potential plus V chi V, which is the contribution coming from the rearrangement of charge around this added particle. So this, the screen Coulomb potential W is precisely the field generated by the Dressed particle or the quasi-particle. So the screen Coulomb potential has very nice properties, in particular, if you want to do perturbation theory. So as I was telling you, if you put a negative charge, you are going to repel negative charge around Q. So that this hole is basically a depletion of negative charge. And actually, if you are in a metal, and it should remind you of the exchange correlation sum rule in DFT, if you are in a metal, the depletion of charge around the added electron is just equal to one electron, which basically means that the charge associated with this Dressed particle or the quasi-particle is much reduced as compared to the bare free charge. Namely, the screen Coulomb potential is much weaker, much reduced as compared to the bare Coulomb potential. And so this is an old picture which I like. It's coming from a lecture by Raffaele Resta at CISA in Italy. And it's plotting the screen Coulomb potential divided by the bare Coulomb potential in real space. So it's a ratio of the screen Coulomb potential divided by the bare Coulomb potential. So at short range, this ratio is equal to one. At short range, you cannot have screening of your potential because at short range, you cannot build a full depletion hole. Your depletion hole needs some space length to be able to build. But if you go away in the case of a metal, for example, in the case of aluminum, you can show that your screen Coulomb potential W is exponentially decaying. And it's really related to the fact that in a metal, the screening is complete. Namely, the hole amounts to one charge so that your quasi-particle is a neutral object with a very short range generated potential. In a semiconductor where your charges cannot move as freely as they would like to screen out the added charge, what is known is that in the long range, your screen Coulomb potential is converging to the bare Coulomb potential reduced by the macroscopic dielectric constant. So typically in silicon, the macroscopic dielectric constant is 13. Namely, you have reduced by one order of magnitude the strength of your screen Coulomb potential W as compared to the bare Coulomb potential. And so you can understand that if you want to do a perturbation theory, it's much better to do it in terms of W, which is a weaker perturbation as compared to the bare Coulomb potential V, which is much stronger. And that's hand wavingly the message, the spirit behind the GW approximation. So in summary, when you do a photo emission experiment, what you create in your system is not a bare electron or a bare hole. What you create is an electron surrounded by the rearrangement of charge, which is adiabatically created by this charge you added. So when you do a photo emission experiment, what you add and what you remove is really a quasi-particule. And so the energy of what you measure is the energy of a quasi-particule, and not the energy of a bare electron, because your electrons are interacting. And the second thing is that your quasi-particles are interacting through the screen Coulomb potential W, and no longer with respect to the bare Coulomb potential V. So the spirit of the GW approach and the quasi-particle approach in general is to reformulate the problem of bare electrons interacting via the bare Coulomb potential by quasi-particle or dressed electron interacting with a much weaker screen Coulomb potential. Namely, you are making a step in direction of weakly interacting particles, namely weakly interacting quasi-particle or dressed electrons or dressed hole. And so it makes much sense to try to generalize what we have seen, the JV operator, which was just the bare exchange operator, by the GW operator, which could be called, even though it's quite inaccurate formulation, which could be labeled a screened exchange. So the second quantity I will need is the dielectric matrix or the dielectric function epsilon or epsilon minus one of omega. So let's generalize what we did, namely what we have done in the previous slide is introduced a charge which is generating a Coulomb perturbation. So now let's imagine the response of your system to an external perturbation, which I will call U, which is now local in space and time. So I will have this composite notation. So one is a space-time variable, R1 and T1. And so let's introduce now the dynamical susceptibility of R1, T1, and R2, T2, which is just the derivative of the charge density in R1, T1, divided by the perturbation U of R2, T2. And this rearrangement of charge is generating a variation of the R3 potential, since a variation of the charge density multiplied by the Coulomb potential, or convoluted by the Coulomb potential, gives you the variation of the R3 potential, the classical electrostatic contribution to electron-electron interaction, as a function of the external perturbation U. And in what follows, I will write V of 1/3, not forgetting that the bare Coulomb potential is an instantaneous interaction, namely it's a delta function of T1 minus T3 for V1/3. And so if we introduce a total electrostatic potential, that is not only the external perturbation, but also the rearrangement of the R3 potential, so that the total electrostatic potential rearrangement seen by an electron, you define the inverse dielectric function, epsilon minus one of one and two, as the variation of the total electrostatic potential by the external applied perturbation. And you can generalize the way we have been defining our screen Coulomb potential. The screen Coulomb potential of 1 and 2 is the bare Coulomb potential renormalized by the inverse dielectric function epsilon minus 1. That could be a definition for epsilon minus 1. So what is quite important is that V is static. You have this delta function. But of course, epsilon minus 1 is a dynamical object, so that your screen Coulomb potential, either in time or by Fourier transform in a frequency representation, is a dynamical object. Namely, it depends on the frequency of the perturbing potential. So in case you don't believe me, this is a graph which is very well known for solid state physicists. This is an experimental graph of the dielectric function of bulk silicon, so the inverse of the inverse dielectric function in the macroscopic limit. and you recognize a shape which is well known, you have the imaginary part of epsilon with two peaks, and you have the real part of epsilon of omega, is omega from infrared to UV, with a low frequency limit, namely the macroscopic static dielectric constant of silicon, which is about 13. So the screen Coulomb potential, as compared to the bare Coulomb potential, is not only a quantity which is much weaker in magnitude, but it's also, and that's an additional complication, a dynamical object. So these were quite qualitative arguments. And at some point, if we want to progress, we have to do some math. So I will not do much math because with Zoom, it's a nightmare. But I will try to go through a bit of what is called functional derivative techniques, which is a technique used in the original paper to derive the GW and beyond formalism. You could use Feynman diagrams, which are a bit nicer when you do presentation, but maybe it's more complicated to use Feynman diagrams after if you want to.
Mein Prof hat Feynman Diagramms geliebt. Diagramme. Ja, ich habe mich damit nie beschäftigt. Ich so, ich weiß, ich soll das wissen.
Maria, could you switch off your mic?
Ja.
So what I will going to show is the two equations which are absolutely central to the GW formalism. The first one is quite central to Green's function formalism in general. That's the time evolution of the Green's function, namely the derivative of G12, R1T1, R2T2, by the time T1. So it's a very general equation. The second equation, which is much more specific to the GW formalism, because it's related to linear response and to the all the objects I've been introducing, namely the susceptibility, the screen Coulomb potential, and the inverse dielectric function. That's the derivative or the response of the one-body Green's function with respect to an external perturbation U. So let's go to the first equation, the one-body time order G equation of motion. So the name of the game is just to take the time derivative of the Green's function of RT and R prime T prime. And so I put in red the variable that you must derive. So as you can see, you must derive a T variable into Heaviside function. So that's the electron channel and the whole channel as we discussed last week. And so derivative of Heaviside function will give you delta functions of T minus T prime, but you also have to derive the field destruction operator in the Heisenberg representation. In the Heisenberg representation, your operators are time dependent and your wave function are time independent. So you don't have to derive them. So I put a few notes in the appendix. This first step is actually quite easy. You can show that if you do very straightforwardly this derivation, you will have the first expression for the equation of motion of G. You will see that the derivative of the Green's function is this delta function. You remember that the Green's function is a solution of a Schrodinger equation with the right hand side, which is a delta source term. And you still have to take the derivative of the destruction field operator, which appear in the time ordering operator sandwich into the n electron ground state. So this we know how to do because we know the equation of motion of an operator in the Heisenberg representation. We know that we have to take the commutator. I put the minus sign, so the true commutator. psi h minus h psi. And we know, or we should know, or I don't have time to rederive it, that the Hamiltonian in second quantization can be written in terms of field operators. So here the field operators are not, have no time, so they are in their Schrodinger representation, where here you have the one body term. So H0 is basically the kinetic energy and the ionic potential. And you have the two body term. Here you recognize the Coulomb potential. And for the two body term, you have four field operators. You have two destruction operators and two creation operators and two destruction field operators. So basically you will have the commutator of one destruction operator with two field operators and four field operators. And the name of the game is to play a lot with the commutation relation we have been seeing last week with respect to this field destruction and creation field operators. So if you do that, you end up with this expression for the equation of motion of the destruction operator, namely the derivative of the field destruction operator is just the action of the one body part of the Hamiltonian, and the Coulomb potential is acting on a product of three field operators, a creation and two destruction. So that if you put that in this commutator where you had already a creation operator, you end up with this equation of motion for the Green's function, where you have the action of the one body Hamiltonian, the delta function source term on the right hand side, and finally, the Coulomb interaction appears as an integral over the bare Coulomb potential times this nasty object where you have two creation, two field creation operators and two destruction field operators. That's by definition a two-body Green's function because that's an operator which is going to create two electrons or destroy two electrons. And we have seen that the one-body Green's function creates one electron or destroys one electron. So this is really a two-body Green's function, creating a pair of electrons or destroying a pair of electrons. So if you look at textbooks, very often you will see this nasty time plus plus or time plus. So don't be afraid with that. It's just a trick to tell the time ordering operator that this product of three field operators should be kept in the same order when you plug these three operators under the time ordering action. So it's just a mathematical trick to make sure that the ordering of these operators is correct when you put that in a time ordering operator, of which the role is to potentially reorder everything from the left to the right with descending order in time. So if you, so I will try to go to nicer, I don't know if there are nicer notations. I will call RT the variable one, R2, T2, R prime, T prime, the two variable, and three is R second T. And if you do that, you end up with a reformulation of your equation of motion of your one body Green's function, which implies the two-body Green's function. And this is really nasty because you say, okay, I just want the equation of motion of the one-body Green's function because I want to calculate it in the case of an interacting system. And if I do my job honestly, I realize, well, if I want to solve the equation for the one-body Green's function, I need to know the two-body Green's function, which is an even more complicated object. And if I want to solve the equation of motion for the two-body Green's function, I will realize that I will need the three-body Green's function and then the four-body Green's function. And this, as you can see, is a process which is increasingly complex. You end up with what is called a hierarchy of Green's function that you cannot manage very quickly. And at some point, you have to stop this expansion. And at some point, you have to make a closing approximation for your Green's function at the second, the third, or the first order. So that's the basics of Green's function perturbation theory to know how to stop by an approximation this hierarchy of Green's function. So the GW formalism is a bit different in spirit because as we will see, the way the GW and Edin went around this problem is by using another equation that involves the very same two-body Green's function so as to be able to eliminate this nasty two-body Green's function. So that's the equation I was telling you, that the second equation, which is now connecting to linear response. So I will not demonstrate it. So the best demonstration is probably in, or the best hints to the demonstration is in the article by Strinati, which I gave you at the beginning of this lecture. And maybe Matteo Gatti will give you a demonstration in his Bethe-Salpeter lecture, because this equation is also very central to the Bethe-Salpeter formalism devoted to optical excitation in many body Green's function perturbation theory. But so this equation, as I was telling you, is no longer concerned with the time evolution of the Green's function, but with the linear response behavior, namely, how is the Green's function changing when you apply an external perturbation, which is local in time and in space. So you could also look at the derivative with a non-local perturbation, but it's an additional complexity that we do not need for the GW formalism. So I will not go through the demonstration. You need to use interaction representation, so additional pages of calculation. But the final result is that this derivative can be very nicely expressed as a product of two one-body Green's functions. And even with the one-body Green's function of 3 and 3 plus, if you remember what we said last week, this Green's function of 3 and 3 plus is by definition the charge density of R3 T3 with a minus 1 sign, plus a complex term which has the quality of being exactly the G2, the two-body Green's function that appeared in the equation, the time equation of motion of our one body Green's function. So as a summary, we have this linear response property equation that involves the derivative of Green's function with respect to U, involving the two-body Green's function and the product of one-body Green's function. And you have the equation of motion, time evolution of the Green's function involving the very same two-body Green's function. And the trick is just to eliminate the two G2 in these two equations so as to replace that term by a term that contains the product of G1 to G3, 3 plus. This is what I write here. And a term that contains the derivative of G with respect to U. So that's these terms that I put in red. Okay, so let's look at this first term. So it's a bare Coulomb potential time G of 3 plus acting on G12. It's really coming from that contribution. So as we said, minus I of G of 3 plus is just the charge density. So that here, this operator in blue is just the bare Coulomb potential convoluted by the charge density. It's by definition the R3 potential. So the first term is just the action of the R3 potential onto the one-body Green's function. And the red contribution now is whatever comes from electron-electron interaction beyond the R3 interaction, which is in blue. Namely, whatever is left is called exchange and correlation contribution. So it looks a bit nasty, and it is. And the first thing you notice is that it's not an operator acting on the Green's function. We are looking for an operator acting on the Green's function G12. Here you can see that there is a derivative of G12 with respect to U. But it's not a big problem. And that's the essence of functional derivative techniques. If you want an operator acting on the Green's function, well, just make it happen. And one way of making it happen is to use the definition of the inverse Green's function. So this equation introduces the derivation of the inverse Green's function. G integral of g minus 1/4 g52 is equal to delta 4/2. Now you replace these two variables here by integral over 4 for delta 4/2. Okay.
Excuse me. Sorry. Can I ask you a question?
Yes, sure.
Okay. So it's about this derivative of the Green function with respect to u. So, I mean, a derivative is always evaluated at some point. So,
tell me if I'm wrong,
but you start from, let's say, a nuclear potential that is local and time independent, okay? And now you simulate a slight perturbation, which is still local, right? And it's also time dependent.
Yes.
So you evaluate this derivative because you go back to the original potential when you evaluate the derivative. So
yeah,
at the nuclear potential or?
It's a good point, Emmanuel. So so you switch on a tiny external potential that you take to zero once the derivation is made. So okay. This derivative is basically taken in the limit of an infinitely small u.
Okay, so the original potential is the nuclear potential for a molecule, for example.
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly, yes.
Okay, thank you.
So where was I? Okay, I was with this delta function. So you just rewrite this with a delta function and you replace the delta 4/2 by g minus 1 times g. And if you do that, the maths are rather simple, even though it may look very formal to you. You created an operator which has the nice property of acting on the Green's function. With the price to pay is that your operator in this bracket is a bit more complicated because now there is a g minus 1 Green's function on the right hand side of this operator. And so this operator, as I say, which is acting on the Green's function, accounts for exchange and correlation effect. So you may think, well, where is this going? I mean, it's getting more and more complicated with g minus 1 derivative of g. And I may agree with you, but you will see that in a few slides, we are going to simplify all this. But the first thing I would like to pay attention to is that this operator is integrating over a lot of variables. It's integrating over 3 and integrating over 4. So that at the end of the day is just a self-energy operator and it's just a two-body operator. Namely, it's just an operator changing notation of rt and r prime t prime. Namely, if you do a Fourier transform of t minus t prime, it's just an operator of r and r prime and of omega. So which means, so it's an exact demonstration that in the equation of motion for the Green's function, your exchange correlation operator is a two-body operator, which is non-local. So this is not very surprising. The exchange operator is non-local. And it's what is new is that it is frequency dependent. So that's what is very new with respect to the exchange operator, which is instantaneous. And with the exchange correlation potential in DFT, at least in the adiabatic approximation. And so this is very much exact. The expression is complicated, but I know that exchange and correlation can be reformulated very much as in Hartree-Fock or Kohn-Cham as a non-local two-body operator, but a dynamical operator. And as a matter of fact, if I plug the spectral representation of the Green's function with its pole at the proper electron addition and removal energies, and with its Lehmann weights into the Fourier transform of the equation of motion, I end up with a very standard one-body equation where you recognize the kinetic energy, the ionic potential, the R3 potential, and the self-energy, which accounts for exchange and correlation. So it's a very standard one-body equation, as we have seen for R3-Fock or Kohn-Sham, but now the eigenvalues are the true definition of the electronic energy level as measured by a photoemission experiment. And these one-body wave functions are Lehmann weights that in principle you could identify to molecular orbitals, Kohn-Sham or R3-Fock in the case of a non-interacting system. Okay, so you end up with the very same equation we have been using in Kohn-Sham or in R3-Fock, but here the solution of this equation is a proper definition of electronic energy level, and the price to pay now is that your self-energy exchange correlation operator is dynamical, and as a matter of fact, it must be taken at the energy of the state it is acting on. Okay, so that's what is quite new as compared to the exchange operator or the adiabatic exchange correlation potential in DFT. So, of course, this is still very formal. I've been just putting complexity on one side to complexity in the operator. So you will have to survive a few more manipulations to go to the GW formalism. So another nice trick of functional derivative is that this derivative of the Green's function with respect to U, so as you can see, if you want to have something which look like JV or JW in the operator, you are missing a J. You have the J minus one and you have the derivative of J with respect to U. And again, if you want a J, make it happen, create it. And so here you again take the definition of the inverse Green's function and you take the derivative of this relation in order to express the derivative with respect to U of J as a function of a product of two Green's functions and now the derivative of G minus one. So you plug that expression into the derivative of G, you end up with that, and this product, which integrated with the four variables, is precisely a delta function by the definition of G minus one, so that you slowly start to see appearing an operator which, so it's no longer, it's not GW yet, it looks like more JV, the exchange operator, renormalized or multiplied by this derivative of G minus one with respect to U. So all these maths are rather simple. You just need to understand a bit where you are going. So the last trick is to use chain rule. So what we have been doing so far is to derive with respect to the external perturbation. Okay. So what we are going to do now is to derive G minus one by the total external perturbation, which is the sum of U plus the R3 potential. And if you use chain rule, you derive by V, and then you derive V by U with a new integration variable seven. So why is this interesting? That's interesting because this object, the derivative of V with respect to U, we have seen it a few slides ago. This is by definition epsilon minus one of 7.3, namely the inverse dielectric function. And if you integrate with respect to 3, the product of V and epsilon minus one, you end up with a screen Coulomb potential. So you have been manipulating things so as to make appear this self-energy as the GW operator times the complex object, which is called the irreducible vertex correction. So it's called irreducible because you derive by the total electrostatic potential, not by the external potential. So if you look at this object, you see that you have nice and smooth operators, which are two-body operators, J16 and W17. And you have one object which is a bit less nice. It's a vertex Green's function, which is a three-body operator. So the last step is to use the Dyson equation we have been introducing last time. You remember we looked at the relation between the Green's function of a perturbed system and the Green's function, which I wrote G naught of a non-perturbed system. And we ended up with the so-called Dyson equation. Namely, you can say that the inverse of the interacting Green function is the inverse of the Green's function associated with the one body H0 Hamiltonian minus whatever comes after H0 in the true Hamiltonian, that is the exchange correlation self-energy, the external perturbation U plus the R3 potential. And why is this useful is that remember that we still need to take the derivative of G minus one with respect to the total electrostatic potential. And so G naught minus one does not depend on any perturbation. It's the unperturbed Green's function, so that its derivative is zero. The derivative of V with respect to V is going to give this delta wave function. And the derivative of sigma with respect to V will give you this last correction, which is an higher order term with respect to this very simple product of delta function. And the GW approximation amounts to keeping the vertex correction to its lowest order approximation, or the approximation you can use first without knowing sigma, namely this product of two delta functions. And that's the GW self-energy operator for the exchange correlation, which is the scope of this present lecture. So that's written in a time representation by Fourier transform. You could go to a frequency representation. And if you remember, it looks like very much the integral we have been using for the exchange operator. But with the exchange operator, we had the bare Coulomb potential, which is now replaced by the dynamical screen Coulomb potential. And it's also, you can see that it's a convolution structure. You have W, the screen Coulomb potential in omega, and the Green's function is to be taken in epsilon plus omega, where epsilon is the energy at which you want to calculate the exchange correlation self-energy. So I will pose a bit more on this story of vertex. So if you look at these two equations, you have the self-energy, which depends on G, on W, and on the vertex. Oops, I should have a tilde. It's an irreducible vertex here. And this vertex, you can express it as a lowest order product of delta function, and the terms that depend on sigma, sigma, which you are looking for. So it has again a Dyson-like structure. You have sigma on the left that you can express as a function of operators of which the highest order depends on sigma. So to lowest order, as we said, you can just keep this product of delta function. You end up with a GW approximation. And of course, you can re-inject this lowest order expression for sigma into the definition of the vertex function. And you can see that this correction to the delta function for the vertex will be basically linear in omega, which means that if you put that gamma with this corrective term, which is linear in omega, multiplied by omega, you will see that including the vertex correction will include contribution to the self-energy, which are to higher order in the screen Coulomb potential W, namely at minimum in of the order of W square. So that's another way of looking at the GW formalism, namely it's a lowest perturbation, not as a function of the bare Coulomb potential, but as a function of the screen Coulomb potential, which, as we said, in principle, is much weak, is a much weaker object than the bare Coulomb potential between bare electrons or, or bare electrons and holes. So this little digression is just a tiny bit of what is called Eddin set of self-consistent equations. So it's self-consistent because, as we said, sigma depends on gamma, and gamma depends on sigma. And if you play a bit with all the quantities we have been introducing, you see this structure of five quantities, which are the Green's function, the vertex correction, the susceptibility, the screen Coulomb potential, and the self-energy, which all depends of each other. And so it's called the Eddin pentagram or the Eddin cycle, because one way of solving exactly this set of equations, in principle, in practice, no one does it, is to cycle around this set of equations. So you start with whatever Green's function you can calculate easily, and typically in the community, you start with the Kohn-Sham Green's function, with the Kohn-Sham eigenvalues and Kohn-Sham, Kohn-Sham energies. You skip, in the first round, you skip the calculation of the vertex correction, or at least you take as an approximation to the vertex correction, this product of delta function, which I call one. You create a susceptibility from which you can calculate a screen Coulomb potential, through which you can calculate the GW self-energy with gamma equal to one. And from this, so you could stop here, that's the GW formalism, but in principle, you could keep going. Namely, with this self-energy, you can calculate an updated GW Green's function through this Dyson equation, from which you calculate an higher order vertex correction, which allows you to calculate an higher order susceptibility, an higher order W, and a self-energy with a proper vertex correction. So this is in principle a way to go to exact solutions. I'm not telling you it's easy, but that's in principle a way to go, in particular to systems which are very strongly correlated, even though in practice, no one really tried to cycle this pentagon, because basically it's very expensive. And so for me, the way I see the GW formalism is that stopping at the first iteration, namely the GW approximation, gives you something which is really amazing in terms of accuracy to cost. It's a rather cheap technique. It's a low-level technique. Now, can we tackle strongly correlated system by cycling the Eddin's pentagon? And is it more efficient to do that rather than other techniques, which could be QMC, which could be DMFT, which could be coupled cluster to in quantum chemistry? I'm not sure there is an answer to that question. So the practical GW formalism, which is called the G not W not. So as I said, you need something to start with. You need a Green's function and a screen Coulomb potential to build your GW operator. And the philosophy is to take the best Green's function you have with a reasonable cost, and the best Green's function you have is a Kohn-Sham Green's function, where you replace the Lehmann weights by the Kohn-Sham molecular orbitals, and where the energy poles, the energy denominators, are just the Kohn-Sham eigenvalues. And the screen Coulomb potential, you build it with the irreducible or Kohn-Sham independent electron susceptibility, with again the Kohn-Sham molecular orbital and the difference of energy between occupied and unoccupied Kohn-Sham energy level. And this gives you the Cohn-Sham Green's function and the Cohn-Sham related self-energy, screen Coulomb potential, so that you can make your first order GW operator, and it's called G not W not, because you start from, because your Green's function is a zeroth order, to some extent, Cohn-Sham Green's function, and your screen Coulomb potential is a zeroth order Cohn-Sham screen Coulomb potential. And traditionally, the way you get GW electronic energy level in perturbation series spirit is that you just take the Cohn-Sham eigenvalues, you remove the, I will call the spurious exchange correlation DFT contribution. This exchange correlation DFT contribution was not designed for electronic energy level. It was designed to have a good charge density and a good total energy. And you replace the DFT exchange correlation potential by a proper definition, a better definition of exchange correlation operator, which is a GW self-energy calculated at the quasi-particle energy. So that again, you see that you have some kind of a self-consistent equation. I will come to this point in a few slides. So does it work? So we could have done all this, and then I show you graphs where it's a catastrophe, where everything is wrong. But of course, if the GW formalism is popular, it's because it's not that bad. And when I say it's not that bad, it's not that bad taking into account the fact that it's a quartic scaling formalism, which allows you to deal with quite a large number of atoms. And you even have nowadays cubic scaling algorithms, which are really extremely efficient. So this is a very famous plot of the band gap of inorganic semiconductors and insulators. So as I briefly mentioned at the beginning of this lecture, the GW formalism was first used for the homogeneous interacting electron gas by Edin, and it was in the 80s first applied at the ab initio level to semiconductors in solid state physics, silicon insulators, gallium arsenide. And so this is a plot of band gaps of so the first diagonal, if your theoretical points are on the first diagonal, it means that they are in very good agreement with experimental value of the band gap as given by angle resolved direct and inverse photoemission. And these are the calculated gaps. So the red dots are what physicists would, solid state physicists were using at the beginning. Exact exchange is not that commonly implemented in standard solid state physics codes because it's complicated to do. So the first calculation of band structure were done within DFT in the LDA or in the PBE local or semi-local exchange correlation approximation to VXC. And as we know, the band gap as given by LDA is really too small. So one should not criticize DFT. It's just that DFT in its original formulation was not designed to reproduce electronic energy levels. The Cohn-Sham level are just ansatz, variational ansatz, in the search for a proper total energy and charge density. But as you can see, for example, if you take silicon, the experimental band gap of silicon is 1.2. And within Cohn-Sham LDA, Cohn-Sham PB, the typical band gap is of the order of 0.6 EV. So you are 50 or 100% too small. And there are even situations, and it's bringing a lot of confusion. You have some systems which are semiconducting experimentally. So here you see that you have a positive gap. And if you do a LDA calculation, you have a negative gap. So it should not be interpreted by saying that these materials are strongly correlated, they have a correlation gap. No, it just should be interpreted by the fact that Kohn-Sham and Zatz are not designed to reproduce accurately them gap. So if you're a quantum chemist, you know another approach, another mean field approach with these R3-Fock. And so R3-Fock for small size molecules is actually quite nice because small molecules, few electrons means weak correlations in general, if you are not in an open shell system. But in the case of silicon, it's a bit, so silicon is here, it's a bit catastrophic. With an R3-Fock, the band gap of silicon is of the order of 5.5 EVs. I think these calculations were done with a crystal code originally. So it's periodic code with Gaussian orbitals. So as you can see, R3-Fock is quite dramatic. So of course, in the middle, you have all the hybrids. You see that the R3-Fock gap is too large. The Kohn-Sham gap with local functional is too small. So if you take an hybrid, you know that there is some hybrid functionals which will give you the proper gap. But the question is, which mixing should you be using in an ab initio fashion, namely without knowing the result, to get the proper experimental gap? So that's all the story of hybrid functional, tuned hybrid functional, Koopmans compliant hybrid functional, Rolle separated hybrid functional. But what we do today's difference is the GW perturbation theory, and that's this lowest order G naught W naught using input Kohn-Sham orbital given with LDA local exchange correlation potential. And these are these black dots. So as you can see, it's not perfect. You could improve, but it's already much, much better. Okay, you see that the agreement with experiment is within 0.1, 0.2, or let's say 0.3 EV, or a bit more. This could be one EV in this scale of this oxide. So oxide and D level is not very good for LDA, I would suspect. But if you compare to Kohn-Sham and R3-Fock, you can see that the results are much, much better.
Xavier?
Yes.
Can I ask you a question to really understand this graph? So in the previous slide, you expressed like a quasi-energy or something like that. So what is it exactly? Is it the on the previous slide? So yeah, so what you evaluate here is kind of minus the exact or accurate ionization potential or
no, so on this slide I say that I do a GW calculation on top of LDA,
yeah,
which means that I do an LDA calculation. I have one body molecular orbitals or block states.
Yeah.
And I build the LDA Green's function, the LDA independent electron susceptibility, the LDA related screen Coulomb potential, and I have a G naught W naught operator built from LDA eigenstate.
Yeah.
And here I take the LDA Kohn-Sham eigenvalues.
So
the HOMO or the LUMO.
So both, you split both. I mean, you apply the self-energy correction to both the HOMO and the LUMO so that you correct the-
All levels.
All levels, okay.
Yeah, N is mapping all occupied and all unoccupied level.
Okay. So the
and both HOMO I and the remove-
are changed, right?
Sorry,
both the HOMO and the LUMO are changing. And
yes.
Change the gap, I mean the culture.
Yes. Usually, if you start from LDA, you push the LUMO level towards higher energy, and you push the HOMO level towards lower energy. So you increase the ionization potential and you reduce the electronic affinity.
Now I have a question. If you are in exact DFT, you have the IP theorem. So in principle, the energy of the HOMO should correspond exactly to the ionization potential. So if you use that constraint, can you learn about the exchange correlation potential, for example? Because it has to mimic somehow, I guess it has to complement the effect of the self energy, right? So is this another way to learn about the accurate potential?
So if you have such a potential which satisfies the ionization potential theorem, so this will not do anything onto your HOMO energy.
Yes.
But what will it do to the LUMO energy?
Then I guess it will have an impact, right?
It will have an impact probably on the LUMO energy. So again, GW formalism will correct all your energy levels. Okay. That's, by the way, one of the very nice things. In a finite system, you could do a delta SCF calculation for the ionization potential and the electronic affinity, and that would not be that bad. It's not as good as one may think. It's also very much depending on the functional. But with this delta SCF technique, you can only access frontier orbital energies. With the GW formalism, you have the entire energy level, the entire spectrum of energy level. Once you have the self energy, you can calculate the correction to any energy level.
Okay. Okay. Which is important, of course, for bound structures and so on.
It's important for bound structure, but it's also important after if you want to do optical properties.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because we know that transition will include not only HOMO LUMO contribution, but also a contribution from HOMO minus one, LUMO plus one, HOMO minus two, LUMO plus five. So if you want after to have the entire optical spectrum using this proper definition of electronic energy levels, and that will be the spirit of the Bethe-Salpeter formalism, then you really need to correct all your levels.
I see. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. So I decided to flash a few working slides to show you the nice things. So yeah, I'm answering that question right now. So the question is, you build your self-energy with input Kohn-Cham or Hartree-Fock eigenstate, and has this an effect onto the self-energy operator you are constructing? And the answer is yes. And this is precisely what this slide is about, if I understand your question, Quentin. So this is a calculation of the HOMO-LUMO gap of pentacin. So it's not a very nicely converged calculation. Doesn't really matter. It's a 6311 G star triple zeta plus polarization purple basis. So this is the HOMO-LUMO gap of pentacin, and you start with the Kohn-Cham gap. So these are the PBE functionals, PBE family of functionals, where you change the amount of exact exchange. So you go from PBE to PBE0 at 25% of exact exchange, and you can put 100% of exact exchange, or here 90% of exact exchange. And as you can see, is what we said. The Kohn-Cham gap strongly depends on the exchange correlation potential you are using, and strongly depends on the amount of exact exchange that has entered your hybrid functional, global hybrid in the present case. And then we do a G not W not calculation, starting with the PB Kohn-Cham eigenvalues, and that's the G not W not band gap I obtain after correcting separately the HOMO and the LUMO, as we said. So you start from PB0 Kohn-Cham eigenstate, and you use this PB0 Kohn-Cham eigenstate to build the GW value of the band gap. And this would be about 50% of exact exchange. So as you can see, so the red line is the experimental value, and the horizontal dashed blue line is a complete basis set limit, couple cluster, single, double, triple perturbative, namely the theoretical reference. we know that the experimental reference might not be the proper target for the calculation of a vertical excitation energy. So the answer to your question is yes. The G not W not calculation are much better, but still, as you ask, you see that there is a dependence on the starting functional. And as we have seen, what we did is a very low order process. We take the exchange correlation potential and you replace it by the GW self energy. And so you can understand that if your gap to correct is very far away from the final result, you see that your low order perturbation theory will not be that good. So one way to bypass, a very simple way to bypass this is to do self-consistency in your GW formalism. And in particular, a very simple self-consistent way of proceeding is that you start with Kohn-Cham eigenvalues, you correct the Kohn-Cham eigenvalues, so you have better GW eigenvalues, and so you can use these improved eigenvalues to build a new Green's function and a new independent electron susceptibility and a new screen Coulomb potential, namely a new GW operator. So it's a very simple self-consistency on the eigenvalues where you basically update your energy denominator, but you don't touch at your Lehmann weights, which are here just the Kohn-Cham molecular orbitals. So this scheme, which is called the partially self-consistent GW scheme, partially self-consistent on the eigenvalues, give you the Green's dots, which, as you can see, are not only in much better agreement with whatever reference you want to take, but also because of the self-consistency, you have dramatically removed the dependence on the starting Kohn-Cham functional used to build your zeroth order Green's function and screen Coulomb potential. And so typically this EVGW, partially self-consistent technique on the eigenvalues, is very efficient and very popular techniques when you deal with organic system. The other technique, of course, being to improve the starting point. So trying to use some Kohn-Cham functional, which gives you the same result than the starting G not W not calculation. So if you improve your starting point, and as you can see, this means that you need a lot of exact exchange, your G not W not to low order will be very accurate. And of course it will be very accurate because your Kohn-Cham starting point is already very close. Someone wanted to unmute, I unmute someone. So practical aspects. So the GW formalism is what I would call an explicitly correlated technique in the sense that you build your correlation using basically diagrams or matrix elements involving occupied to empty contributions, a bit like when you do couple cluster. And as any explicitly correlated techniques, it's converging rather slowly with basis size. And so this is taken by the same study I've been showing, the couple cluster calculation for ASINs. So that's a GW calculation for the ionization potential of ASINs and the electronic affinity of ASINs, and that the result as a deviation with respect to augmented double zeta basis. And as you can see, you really need to work very hard to get the complete basis set limit. As you can see, augmented triple zeta, augmented quadruple zeta, augmented five zeta is not yet at the kind of accuracy that you would like, at least for this kind of systems. The very nice thing is that the basis dependence of the ionization potential or the HOMO energy or the electronic affinity of or minus the LUMO energy are very similar. So that if you are interested in the gap ionization potential minus electronic affinity, then you see that it's converging extremely fast. As a matter of fact, augmented double zeta basis or augmented triple zeta basis, you are already within 50 milliEVs for augmented delta, augmented double zeta basis. You are within 50 milliEVs as compared to a very well converged calculation. But this is a signature that GW, in contrast with Cohn-Sham, with this exchange correlation potential implicitly depending on the charge density, is explicitly calculating correlations. So I have decided to show you some of the things which are, I would say, unnice. By unnice, I mean they are complicated. And these are difficulties which are actually quite recent. No one really paid attention to that in the early days of GW. So it's related to this equation I've been flashing. So I said that you replace to get the GW quasi-particle energy, your HOMO energy or your LUMO or whatever level calculated with GW, you remove the exchange correlation contribution and you add the GW self-energy at the energy of at the quasi-particle energy that you don't know because that's what you want to calculate. So in fact, what you have to do is to calculate the crossing of this function of omega, where I put omega and I put the Cohn-Sham eigenvalue on the left and I put the exchange correlation contribution on the left. So I have this first function f of omega is equal to omega minus epsilon Cohn-Sham plus the exchange correlation contribution. And that's linear in omega and that's this red line, okay? And you want to equate that to what remains on the right, namely G of omega, which is the expectation value of the exchange correlation shelf energy of omega, expectation value on to the eigenstate you want to correct. And in typical drawings a few years ago, you would see this kind of drawings. Namely, you have a very smooth self energy. And you can see that the crossing of G of omega with this straight line is very straightforward. It's very easy. And you get your quasi-particle energy at the crossing. So now people are getting more interested in this kind of graph, which, as you can see, is more complicated. So as a matter of fact, the self-energy contains the poles of the Green's function and also the poles of the screen Coulomb potential. Actually, it's a convolution of the pole of G and the pole of the Green's function. So the self-energy is a function which is very spiked, which has a lot of singularities if you calculate it straightforwardly along the real axis. And as you can see now, the crossing of the red line with the dynamical self-energy, there are several solutions, because there are several crossings. So you should not count this line as a line. It's actually a discontinuity. Your self-energy goes down to minus infinity and takes it back from plus infinity again to minus infinity. But you see that you have one crossing here, you have one crossing there, and you have one crossing here. So how do you decide? So what is the self-energy? What is the solution of this self-consistent equation? So if you want to have an answer to that question, you need to look at the spectral weight, namely the weight associated with each of these solutions. So what you need to do is take the GW spectral weight, which is related to the imaginary part of the GW Green's function. And the GW Green's function, again, it's a Dyson equation-like, you start from the Cohn-Chandrin's function you know, and so or you would have g minus one of GW is equal to g minus one of Cohn-Cham minus the difference between the two Hamiltonian, which is the exchange correlation GW self-energy minus the BFT exchange correlation potential. And if you look at the spectral function associated, for example, with this problem, you see that in most cases, you see a strong peak that appears. So one property we have been seeing last week is that the integral of the spectral function at all energies should be equal to one. So here it's a situation where you have a principal peak which capture most of the spectral weight. The area under this curve is close to one, but you have also little peaks which are satellites. As I was telling you, the Green's function contains the pole of the GW self-energy, contains the pole of the Green's function and the poles of the screen Coulomb potential. The poles of the screen Coulomb potential are what are called the classement poles, that are the poles of the inverse dielectric function. So the usual representation of a quasi-particle series that can be used is that your independent electron spectral representation with delta function is changed into a main quasi-particle peak with a width. So width is a lifetime which traduces the scattering by the other electrons plus what are called the satellites, could be plasmon replica, of which the weight must be much smaller than the main quasi-particle peak. So this is the ideal situation. This is what is happening most of the time. But it's true that in a few situations, you end up with a spectral weight which looks like this. And so the question is, what is the quasi-particle energy? So this is MGO is a well-known case, a pathological case taken from what is called the GW110 case. And as you can see, if you do G not W not on top of PB0, everything is smooth and easy. But if you start from PBE, I don't know why people should start from PBE to study MGO, but if you happen to be unlucky enough to start with PBE, then you may run into that type of problems, namely situation where you don't really know how to interpret your spectral function, and you don't really know, you are in difficulty to say the quasi-particle energy is associated with this peak or that peak or that peak. In practice, everyone would take that one. So this pathological case are starting to be studied. One of our organizers has been committing a paper along that subject. So that's, you see, that very recent paper. And as a matter of fact, I would have a question to people doing couple cluster calculation. Do you have the same kind of problems? And if you don't have the same kind of problems, I'm not sure I understand where they are hidden. Because this should really be the physics of systems where the notion of quasi-particle is getting difficult. So the last slide, I've been a bit slower than last time. I have been telling you that one of the very nice points about GW was the ratio between accuracy and cost. So accuracy, I've been showing you a few slides. So you have seen that you can get very fair results. Let's say 0.1, 0.2 EV accuracy for most extended systems or molecular systems. But what I've not been telling you is about CPU time. And this is what I was telling you. There is quite a lot of papers appearing in the community, starting with an idea dating back to 95. So the quantum chemists may know this in a language of resolution of the identity, separable resolution of the identity, and Laplace transform. So in the world of physicists, it's called the space-time approach. And the space-time approach is one way of having a GW formalism, which is strictly cubic scaling without relying on any approximation of localization or sparsity. And as you can see, you can now do GW calculation on several thousands of electrons with typically a few thousand hours, so that you can really start to do complicated chemistry or complicated physics with an accuracy which is of the order of 0.1, 0.2 EV on system which contains really hundreds of atoms and thousands of electrons. And that's really what I find very impressive with GW formalism. So I have last slides related to the limitation of the GW formalism. So I think, Emmanuel, one day you invited me and you asked me, so what about strong correlations? So it was...
I probably asked this question, yes.
Yeah, it looks very much like you.
Yes, I guess.
So you ask me to talk about GW in a workshop dedicated to strong correlation. And as I already hinted, GW, at least the way it is defined, usually is not tailored to go to higher correlation. Even though in principle, if you go through this Eddin cycle, you could in principle catch higher order correlation. So there is another way of understanding the problem, which is the one with diagrams. So I didn't talk very much about diagrams, so I invite you to go to the Matuk. Personally, I like it very much. I like it because there are drawings, so sometimes when you don't understand the equations, you can catch something with the drawing. And so what you can show is that the GW formalism only contains what are called the RPA bubble, namely the product of electron Green's function and all Green's function. So this bubble is actually the chi-zero irreducible polarizability. So you have these bubbles to all orders. This is building the screen Coulomb potential W. This is a Green's function, and that's the screen Coulomb potential W, what is called the random class approximation. But the GW formalism is missing a lot of diagrams. For quantum chemists, maybe we'll recognize a second order exchange. So it's missing higher order exchange diagram. So you could correct GW by doing what is called GW plus the SOSX correction. But it's also missing what are called ladder diagrams, where you allow your propagating electrons and propagating hole to interact one time, two times, three times with Coulomb potential. So these are called the ladder diagrams. And you can show very formally, Matuk does it starting with interacting electron gas and discussing the high density and the low density limit. The limit where the kinetic energy dominates and the limit where the potential dominates. So it's going through scaling arguments with these diagrams to demonstrate that if you want to go to strong correlation, you need to have these ladder diagrams. And these ladder diagrams are precisely what you are missing when you do the standard GW approximation. All this to say that if you have something which is strongly correlated, whatever is your definition, sometimes I'm not sure I understand the definition of a strongly correlated system, the GW formalism might not be what you need to treat this kind of problems. And I will stop here. So I have an appendix where I probably made a lot of mistakes in demonstrating the time equation of motion for the Green's function, but at least there is one basis to start with and potentially to criticize if there is one mistake left. Okay, so I think I will stop here because I'm tired and I don't have more slides, so I'm bound to stop. And I thank you for your attention.
So thank you, Xavier, for this really nice lecture, very enlightening. Thank you so much. And you took the time to explain things. That's very nice, very smooth. Thank you so much. So I don't know if there are questions or. Okay, maybe, can I ask you one question? In the derivation of the GW equation, there is this important step where again, you have this derivative of the Green function with respect to this U, and the U is time dependent, right? So when you have shown the derivation of the equation of motion, I guess your Hamiltonian was time independent.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So is there some complexity here when you want to prove this? When you get the derivative of the Green function with respect to some time dependent potential, because now you have the time dependence in the Hamiltonian, right?
So here again, when I write the Dyson equation, so I have the Green's function for the one electron system. And in this V, I have the R3 potential, but I have also the external U.
Which is time dependent.
Which is time dependent, yes.
Okay. So when
but your self-energy is also time dependent, Emmanuel.
No, sure. But when you want to derive the equation of motion, the fact that now the Hamiltonian depends on time, because you use the Heisenberg representation, right? So I was thinking if you...
Okay.
It's a bit more complicated when you derive.
So again, it's related to your question. You have to think that this perturbation is something that you bring to zero at the end.
Okay.
It's your question about where do you take the derivative, and you take the derivative in the limit of vanishing external perturbation.
Okay. So that's why it's manageable, because I guess in a general case, like out of equilibrium problem or whatever, then things are more complicated, right? If you have
sure. You would have to invoke other Green's function, yes.
Okay.
Can I add the one thing?
Yeah, sure, Francesco,
since,
please.
Emanuela asked about the possible complication, there is one that I discovered only very recently. When doing this functional derivative with respect to U of 3, as you explained, Xavier, at the beginning, pointing the Strinati paper and other paper, in general, this U is a function of 3 and 3 plus. But of course, for the derivation of everything, it doesn't really matter. And indeed, it doesn't. For all GW. And now, very recently, I was doing, for a very simple model, second order in W. And there I discovered that if I don't take explicitly into account the little plus, I cannot derive the equations. I have to take care of 3 and 3 plus separately, otherwise all the little eta, all the little timings will not work out. So it can be even more complicated than that if you try to go over the first order.
So I
didn't expect that, actually, but it turns out to be very, very
So as a matter of fact, I wanted to tell you about little pluses. So they look you're not sure you understand why would you put a plus, but at the end of the day, for example, this one plus that you need if you want to make sure that this Green's function that comes from the equation of motion of G, where you have 3 plus and 3++ is the same, that this one, which is in 3 and 3 plus, you need to put a V1 plus. And it is this one plus which will be responsible for this. And it is this phase factor which allows you to close in the upper half plane. So I I fully agree with you, Francesco. It's a mess. It's very easy to get wrong. You really have to pay attention to these little plus plus and these little details, and it's really a mess.
Yep, I agree. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I see no more questions in the chat box.
So I have a question, Manu.
Sure, of course. Yeah.
If the students don't ask questions, I guess we can.
Yeah, sure.
I think you had an interesting comment towards the end of your talk about where are those multiple solutions in couplet cluster theory?
Yes. I don't have the answer, but then you must have the answer.
No, me neither. I don't have it. So I've been thinking about it since like 10 minutes to see what I could say about this, but I don't really. So if you look at the residual equations, so the main difference between couplet cluster theory and obviously
CW
is that the basic equations for couplet cluster, they are made for calculating correlation energy, which is not the case of GW. So you can use couplet clusters to calculate IPs and EAs, so that what they call IP EOMs.
You mean total energies of the n electron system?
Yes.
Okay.
So normally you get total energies, so they might be hiding somewhere, but you don't see them when you calculate total energies. I'm not sure about the IP and EA formalism of couplet cluster. I've actually never used it before. But in the couplet cluster equation, you see that some of the terms actually in the residual equations actually renormalize the R3-Fock eigenvalues.
Okay.
So that's an effective Hamiltonian like in GW. So potentially you could have the same type of problems.
Okay.
But you have much more diagrams. So maybe they're better hiding in couplet cluster than in GW.
Okay.
That's always the problem. I'll try to think about it. That was a good point. That's it.
So I don't know, maybe writing the linear response equation at the couple cluster level could be enlightening. I don't know. Okay, So Xavier, I really would like to thank you. This was very nice, very nice lecture. So
thanks Emmanuel.
Thank you. And I guess this is it. So we see.
Ciao everyone.
Thank you, Xavier.
Bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye, ciao.
Thank you, bye.
Bye, Xavier.
Bye.